Good afternoon, everyone. Real pleasure to be with you. It's about 7 or 8 years since I've been in Glasgow, and it's just lovely to be back here again. Came from Sweden yesterday, where I now live part-time. How many people have heard me speak before? I just want to check. Okay. 17 years I've been making presentations for Forever. My first time, though, to make a presentation for Forever here in Glasgow. So it feels absolutely great. And Forever for me feels like family. I go around the world, I make lots of presentations, different companies. I do work with some other network marketing companies, making presentations for them, but Forever's special. really is. For 17 years, I've been taking the product. I take my Argy and my Aloe and my bee pollen. And I do my C9, and my children take the product. And my mum takes the product, and she's 89, and she likes the bee pollen and the Aloe. And it is a great company, and it's a great opportunity. And the thing that makes Forever special, I believe, is it attracts great people with a great quality of character about them. My story and my path into Forever have been a little bit unusual. I want to share this program with you, the goal mapping program. It's something I've been sharing for a long time, a little more than 20 years now, and it's reached more than 4 million people around the world. And one of the reasons why I get very touched and a bit emotional when I'm working with Forever is because I meet so many Forever people that tell me how they've used this simple system, goal mapping, to achieve something, build their business. But building the business is the what, it's the why. And that's why I love being at the Forever Days, because I hear all these stories about the difference it's made to people to build the business, what they've done with it. And I meet these people that say, oh yeah, I've used your goal mapping, Brian, and I've set some goals and I've built the business and it's helped me to pay off my debt. It's helped me to buy my own home. It's helped me to put the children into a great education. Knowing why you want to build the business is absolutely key. The information about how to build the business, the detail, the process, well, that's clearly laid out. And there's lots of leaders that have achieved, and they will happily share. But your responsibility is to know why you want it. And once you know why you want it, then using a system like goal mapping helps you to follow through with it. So a little more than 4 million people around the world have now been reached with the goal mapping system. I started teaching it in big businesses like Siemens, Disney, Microsoft, Coca-Cola. That work is ongoing. British Telecom alone have put something like 40,000 people into the program over the last 16 years. More importantly for me, school children are receiving the program, and more than 1 million school children across 12 different countries have now created goal maps to increase their grades. And on average, we help children to increase their grades by 20%. And to aim for a brighter future, all the way from university, from primary rather, through to university. Sports people are using the program. This is Kathleen Konya. She's the current female world champion kickboxer 3 years in a row. And this is her goal map that she created that she said helped her win the world championships. She's become one of the teachers of the system. There are about 40 Forever leaders around the world that have gone through the certification and are actually teaching the system. And actually, I've got 1,200 trainers of the system around the world, but I found it's the Forever leaders are the best trainers. They just understand personal development and self-improvement in a very genuine, down-to-earth way. Increasingly, the system's in the news. I was in, I think, 6 different national newspapers with the system last year. This is an article by CNN about using goal mapping to advance your career. All of this is 1 million miles from my start in life. I was born into a traveling family. On both sides of my family, I'm related to the 2 oldest circus families. So on my father's side, Chipperfield Circus are my cousins. And on my mother's side, Smart Circus. And I can trace my ancestry back about 200 years. This is my great-grandmother's traveling wagon in the center of the painting here. And this is in London at Pinner Street Fair. This is my great-grandfather's coconut shy. And this was at the Crystal Palace, again, in London. And then here's my grandfather, my grandmother, with my father sat on the steps of the wagon. And this is my father's funfair. And this picture was taken the year I was born. And they were at Weymouth at the time in the south of England, and the fair got flooded. And he decided, I've had enough of the travelling life. He wanted something a little more stable. And what he did was, what a lot of fairground people did back in the 60s and 70s, was to take all of the fairground equipment to the seaside. And my father spotted an opportunity on the south side of the Isle of Wight, down at the south of England, and he took all of his amusements to a place called Ventnor, and he opened them up, and this is the pier that he used to own here at Ventnor, and he was very successful right from the very first summer season, but he missed the travelling life. If you're born into this world, it's quite hard just to walk away from it. And he missed it. And so the pattern that I grew up with was to have three different homes each year. From the year I was born onwards, I always had three different homes. One home traveling around with the fun fairs for about 4 months every year. Second home on the Isle of Wight while we opened up for the summer season. So through the middle of the summer, we'd take all the fairground equipment to the Isle of Wight. Third home, just by Heathrow Airport. That was our winter base for the really cold weather months, where nobody really wants to go to the fun fair other than perhaps a couple of days over Christmas. So each year, three different homes, three different sets of friends, and always two, sometimes more, different schools each year. No school while we travelled with the fairs. So I only went to school for 5 months each year, and that was split between two different schools. Never, ever sat an exam in my life. Because of the timings when we moved, I missed the exams, or the teachers thought it was unfair for me to sit the exams. Never learned to read and write properly. I have dyslexia, and although there were some really good teachers that tried to help me, and my father paid for me to have my own private tutor, used to come to the caravan and work with me, I just couldn't get it. And I found more and more behind the other children. And around about 13, my dad said, "Would you like to leave school?" And I said, "Yes, please." Now, it sounds strange to a lot of people, but if you grow up in this life, leaving school at 13 is what's normal. My brother left at 13, my sister left at 13, all of my cousins left at 13. And the reason is there are no jobs on the fun fairs. They hire some casual labour, temporary, to do the heavy lifting. There's no proper career jobs. It's a self-employed existence. You inherit the equipment from your parents when they're too old, or they help you get your own. My 13th birthday present was a rocket-shaped bubblegum machine, a box of bubblegum and the keys. And my father taught me, you empty the pennies, you fill it back up with bubblegum, you use the pennies to buy more bubblegum. And after the first year, I had enough money that I bought a peanut machine and then a pin table. My big breakthrough at about 15 was I was one of the first people in the UK to own a Space Invaders. I made quite a lot of money from that. So left school at 13, couldn't read and write, really embarrassed about it. Went to work full-time with my father. And from the outset, my father wanted me to help run the family business. And at around about 18, 19, I took the family business in a new direction. And I became the youngest person ever in the UK at 18 to be granted a liquor and entertainments license. And I opened a disco at 19. And the disco became really famous. We had people coming from all over the country, including here in Scotland, to come down to this little club on the Isle of Wight. And we had lots of pop stars and celebrities, and we're in all the newspapers. And I became incredibly successful. I was very rich, very young. I drove a fast red Ferrari. I lived in a big three-story house on the seafront. I was married to an amazing woman, had a disco to play with, and there was lots of money, and life was very good, basically. I was in that life for 13 years. At the end of the 13 years, a lot of change come. Now, change is constant, like the waves on the ocean are constant. But every so often, the waves come together and they form a big wave, a tsunami. And every once in a while, you get some big changes come into your life. And in the late 1980s, early 90s, I had some huge changes come into my life, and they all happened at the same time. One of the big changes was English people stopped going to the Isle of Wight for their holidays. They started going to Spain and Greece and Italy and places where the sunshine was guaranteed and the beer was cheap and all their friends were going. And so tourism really died on the island and lots of family businesses started going out of business, and my family's business is one of them. And so around about age 29, I found myself in a really desperate situation, which was the family business ended, the disco closed down, all of my possessions started to be repossessed. My car was repossessed, my home was repossessed, I lost all of my income, my marriage broke down under the pressure, my wife ran away with another guy from another network marketing company. Don't make any presentations for them. I moved back into my old bedroom in my parents' house on charity, dragged my parents down in the process. They lost all of their money and they'd put their home up for security against the business. So they were about to be made homeless as well. My brother lost his home. It wiped out the whole family. And after all of my possessions, my home, my car, everything was repossessed, there was still £1 million left owing. This was 1991, when £1 million was even more than it is now. And my mind crumbled on me. I just didn't know what to do. I'd like to tell you I was brave and I faced it and I sorted it out. I didn't. I sat in my bedroom and I just felt absolutely lost and desperate. Didn't want to face the world. I was very, very well known in the area where I lived on the island. I didn't want to face people and explain, oh yeah, my wife's run away and yeah, my home's been repossessed and the business. I just hoped it was a bad dream and I was going to wake up and it would be different. But of course, it was the same each day. And I stayed in my bedroom maybe for about 3 months, hiding from the world. And then one day, there's a knock on the door. And I thought it was the repossession people coming to take my parents' house. And I've crept down the stairs and I've peered through the side window. And it was some friends and they came calling with an opportunity. And the opportunity they offered me was network marketing. In fact, they offered me two opportunities. One was to join their sales team they'd started and the other was to join them in the network. Now, to be honest, I wasn't interested. I had no picture in my mind of me being a salesperson or me being involved in network marketing. I didn't even know really what it was. And they were a little bit hard with me. They said, Brian, you've got to face reality. You're hiding in your bedroom and the reality is simple. You've got £1 million of debt. You've got no qualifications because you never finished school. You've got no formal work experience because you've only worked for yourself or your father. There's nothing for you to put on a job application form. That's if you could write the form. Because we know at age 29, you still can't read and write properly. We think you're ideally qualified for a career in sales and network marketing. Come and join us. And so I joined them and I was absolutely hopeless at it. Absolutely hopeless. Nobody wanted to join me and nobody was buying any product. I can look back now and see why. And it's been said today several times in different ways. People like to join teams with happy and positive people, with the right mindset. I was one of those miserable, sad, oh, my life's all gone wrong people. Nobody wanted to join me. Nobody wanted to work with me. Nobody was interested in buying things from me. And so it wasn't looking very good. But then the good fortune come. And this is something that Forever does really well. Right. The good fortune for me was that I was invited to go to a personal development workshop. Now, I didn't think personal development was the answer. I thought that was a lot of new age nonsense. The only reason I went to the workshop is my upline said, you can come to the workshop or I won't work with you, Brian. I'll come to the workshop. I sat in the workshop with a very closed mind. But some of the things that were being said from the front of the room just made a lot of sense. And the first thing that really hit me was this quote by Henry Ford. If you think you can, and if you think you can't, and either way you prove yourself right. I'd heard it before. Who's heard it before? Right? Most people have heard it before. Here's the difference. The man that was sharing the information was able to explain to me the simple brain science that is behind this saying that helped me to understand why it works, and more importantly, how I could use it in my life. Now, what I learned has not only changed my life, I've gone around the world sharing it now with millions of people, and I know it's helped a lot of other people change their life. And it's a very simple thing, but a lot of people never work it out. Here's what it's about. I get invited into universities to work with professors and share this information, which makes me laugh, because to this day I still have no qualifications whatsoever. But it doesn't seem to matter, because I understand the subject, and the professors I work with like the simple way that I explain it. Inside of your head, my head, somebody else's head, a child's head, all of us have a lot of brain cells. The estimate is you have 100 billion brain cells. Each one of your brain cells has this little tail to it, which is called an axon, and arms or branches that grow out, which are called dendrites. When you have a thought, the thought starts as an electrical impulse, like a spark in the middle of the brain cell. The impulse travels out along the arms and it wants to connect with another arm so you can build a train or a pattern of thought. But there's a little gap that separates all of the arms. It's called the synaptic gap. Now, here's the key point. If the thought that you choose to think, because it's a choice. So if you choose to focus on what's right, if you choose a positive thought about yourself, your life, building your forever business, phoning that list, introducing people to the opportunity. If your thought is positive, the positive impulse starts in the middle of the brain cell, it travels out along the dendrite arms, and it triggers a neuroreceptor to release a chemical into your brain called serotonin. Serotonin is the chemical that gives you the feeling of happiness and well-being. It's the same chemical that's released into your brain if you take an antidepressant drug like Prozac, or an illegal party drug like ecstasy. The challenge is that you become dependent on the drug. Each high is a little bit lower, and you become dependent on the drug just to feel normal. But if you understand the science and you practice positive thinking, you build the neuro pathways and you actually raise your serotonin reservoir. You increase your happiness level. And if you start that practice young, you can actually pass it on to the next generation within your genes. Because some people are born blessed with a higher level of serotonin and happiness. Now, we can all work to get it, but you can pass it on to your children. The other major function here and key point is that serotonin is not only the chemical that gives you a feeling of happiness and well-being, it also acts as a neuroconductor. It joins the brain cells together and it allows your thought to continue on its journey so that you build up a positive train of thought. And it's the joining together of brain cells in this way that helps you come up with new ideas. It's the joining together like this of brain cells that helps you find answers to problems. Every time you have one of those moments, that's the joining of two or more brain cells. Now, there's whole medical papers written on this, but just think about your own life experience. Right now, in this moment, if you were to focus your mind onto some happy thought, a memory from the past, maybe recently, maybe right back in your childhood, as you focus on that happy memory, that happy thought, within a few moments, you'll trigger the release of serotonin. You'll feel happy right now. The thought triggers the chemical that creates the feeling. If you repeat the thoughts over and over, the brain cells become established. It takes a minimum of 10 days of repeating the same thought to establish the brain cell connection. And at that point, the connection becomes a belief. Any belief you have about yourself and life is just the established connection between two or more brain cells. And the key with mindset and personal development is to repeat the positive thoughts more often, so you build those connections and diminish the negative ones. As we build more and more connections, we activate more and more of our brain, and that helps us not only to find ideas and answers to the challenges we face, but through the release of the serotonin, it gives us a good feeling and the motivation to step forward, take our idea, and actually do something with it. If, however, the thought that you think is negative in its nature, then the negative impulse in the brain cell travels out along the arms and it triggers the release of a different chemical into your brain and your body, cortisol. Cortisol is the chemical that's released into your body that creates the feeling of sadness and depression. Now, it happens for a good reason. It's part of your fight or flight response. So if you're in a situation that you think is dangerous, and it doesn't have to be real danger, but if you start to worry about something in your life, your brain and your body release cortisol, and the cortisol gives you the feeling of fear so that you take more care. Now, it's also a chemical messenger. It tells your digestion system to switch off. It shuts down your lymph system, which cleans your body, and it closes down your immune system, which keeps you healthy. And it switches off whole areas of your brain, so your brain becomes tunnel focused on the thing that you fear. And all the energy that's saved by shutting down your secondary systems for a while is diverted to your muscles with adrenaline so you can fight or flight and survive the danger. It works really well. It's helped to protect people for thousands and thousands of years. But here's the important thing to understand. Your body is only designed to be in the fear response for the amount of time you can run flat out and climb a tree. It's by running away from that hungry bear that wants to eat you for lunch, or the pack of wild wolves that are going to rip you apart. By running away through the exercise, you burn off the cortisol, trigger the release of serotonin, and rebalance your brain and body system. The challenges in modern life, the types of dangers that we face are not really the same as thousands of years ago. You know, there's not a hungry bear going to eat us, not unless we're in the wilds of Canada or Norway or somewhere. There's not a pack of wild wolves. It's us simply worrying, are we going to hit our target? Will we receive our bonus? Are we going to have enough money to pay our bills? Can we look after our family? Is our relationship sound? These types of worries aren't the things to run away from, but the brain responds in exactly the same way. The brain doesn't know the difference between a real life-threatening danger and a worry. And when you start to worry about things in your life, you release the cortisol as if the danger's real, even though it's not. And this is why doctors made the link a few years ago between prolonged stress and serious illness. When you're in the fear response over a long period, you start to become ill because your body's prepared to run, but you're not actually running. The cortisol release has told your digestion to switch off. So even if you eat good quality food, you don't get the nutrients from it. Your lymph system isn't cleaning your body. So you'll notice when people are in stress for a long time, they start to become toxic. Their immune system isn't functioning, so they start to pick up colds and flus, and then eventually more serious illnesses. This is why athletes get a high when they work out, because through working out, they burn off the cortisol and trigger the release of serotonin. This is why people experience that if they take exercise, it helps to relieve stress, because again, the exercise is burning off the cortisol, triggering the release of serotonin. But when people go into intense worry about something in their life that concerns them, they're not moving their body enough. And so it starts to cause a lot of damage. And the doctors have been suggesting this for a long time, but it's only in the last 10 years they've been able to prove it, as the scientists have been able to create more powerful electron microscopes and brain scanning equipment. And the doctors can now see in real time that when you think positively about whatever you face in any area of your life, because of the serotonin release, it forms the connections that helps you to use more of your brain. And that in turn helps you to find both answers to problems and the energy to take your answer, your idea, and step forward and do something with it. The brain is basically in two halves. So we've got a left side of the brain and a right side of the brain. Both sides of the brain can do different things. But generally, and it's just a simple model for understanding, the left side of the brain tends to be the more logical side of the brain, and the right side of the brain is the more creative side of the brain. Left brain is management, right brain is leadership. The right side of the brain is emotional, it's free-flowing, it's intuitive. It's gestalt, so it wants to see the whole thing in one go, the big picture. Left side of the brain likes to look at parts and detail. In life generally, and in this business particularly, we need to use both sides of our brain if we're going to be effective. We want to use the right side of the brain to get a good picture and a good feeling of where we are going and why we want to build our forever business. And we need to use the left side of our brain to follow a simple plan so we follow through and we take the actions that are needed to create the results that we want. When I was first shown this, to be honest, I was an absolute skeptic. The right side of the brain is connected to intuition, and my intuition was, well, it feels right. It sort of makes sense. I don't understand all the detail, but it just sort of feels right. The left side of the brain is connected to self-doubt and fear response. And my left brain was going, yeah, but, yeah, but, yeah, but. And I had some war in my head. And to find some peace and to make sure I wasn't passing by something of real help, I made a simple decision, and that was, I'm going to play full out this mind stuff, positive thinking, goal-setting thing. I'm going to do it for a year. And I'll see what difference it makes in the business and in my life. Positive thinking is so simple, but not simplistic. Deeply profound, but misunderstood by most people. The majority of people have the mistaken idea that positive thinking is about walking through your life with your head in the clouds, pretending everything's wonderful, even when it is not. That really isn't positive thinking, that's just delusion. And it's a dangerous thing to do, because if you've got your head in the clouds, you're likely to step into that scary hole in the ground. If you're not aware of the reality of the people around you, and you place unrealistic expectations on other people that they can't live up to, you're just going to become disappointed. And in a similar way, if you're closing your eyes to a negative behavior you have, a bad habit, a limiting belief that's holding you back, those things don't self-correct. We just carry them through life like baggage and they continue to weigh us down. That's why we have positive thinking, personal development, mind shop workshops to work on ourselves, because it's through ourselves that we're influencing our life around us. It's a strange thing, but in many cases, positive thinking actually begins with raising your awareness of what's wrong. We need to know what's in the way, what needs improving, what needs avoiding or correcting. Then the key is, once you're aware, you absolutely hold your dominant thoughts on the positive. You hold your thoughts on where you want to go, what you want to do, who you choose to be. This is a very ancient principle. It's the balance between being aware of the negative, but choosing to focus on the positive. And in ancient times, in different cultures around the world, it was called different things. So in ancient Gnosticism, it was called a movement with repose. Have a focus on where you're going, but have an ease. Be in the flow in the actions you take to get there. In Sufism, it was called an effort with ease. In the Tao, in China, it was called Wu Wei. It's this balance between left brain and right brain. The reason why it's important to understand is because it applies directly to the relationship between your conscious and your unconscious mind. The subconscious part of your mind is really, really powerful. even the low estimates are that your subconscious is many thousands of times more powerful than your conscious mind. It can do the most amazing things that the doctors still don't understand how it can do what it does. It controls all your circulation, your respiration, muscle response, speech, memory. It's estimated about 90% of everything we do every day is done on autopilot through our subconscious. Have you ever had this experience? You get in your car to drive somewhere, you think about your destination, you start driving, your mind drifts on to other things, and before you know it, you're there and you don't remember making the journey. Scenery along the way, the turns you took, traffic lights you stopped at. Who was driving the car? Well, your subconscious was. The one thing that your subconscious cannot do is it can't make choices. It can't make value judgments. It's not able to work out whether what you're thinking about is something you want or something you dread. It doesn't know the difference between what's good for you or bad for you, right for you, wrong for you. It's almost robotic. It follows the strongest thoughts of your conscious mind. Whatever you think about most becomes the target that your subconscious aims for. And when you start thinking about what you don't want, your subconscious doesn't understand it and just moves you towards it. And this is why people go into self-sabotage. About 6 years ago, I run a whole day workshop on this. About 6 years ago in my workshop in London, there's a guy, and we're talking about this, and he's put up his hand. He said, I'm a motorcycle riding instructor. He said, do you know what the big danger is for motorcyclists in England now, Brian? I said, no. He said, it's all of the many holes we've got in the roads. There's been some bad winters. It's broken up the tarmac, the surface of the road. And because the government's short of money, they haven't repaired the roads quickly. And if you hit one of these big holes in a car, it can do a lot of damage. But if you hit one of these big holes on a motorbike, it can be fatal. And several people have died in traffic accidents where they've hit these holes and it's knocked them off their bike and they've been killed. He said, here's what we're now teaching all the motorcyclists to try and help them be safe. Be aware of the hole, but whatever you do, don't stare at the hole. Because if you stare at the hole, you're going to go to the hole. Be aware of the hole, stay focused on where you want to go. This is a great life principle. As we move along our path in life, there'll be many holes. There'll be edges of cliffs and crash barriers and scary places we want to avoid. And to avoid the dangers in life, we need to be aware of them, but not stare at them. Because if we stare at them, we're going to go to them. Now, forever's a path. Forever's a journey. There are holes along the road. Hearing that word no is one of the holes in the forever journey. Be aware it's going to come, but don't stare. Otherwise, at a subconscious level, you'll start to create it and attract it. Hold the thought of what you choose for yourself, for your life, for your success. Because by holding the thought of what you want, that thought becomes stronger than the thoughts of what you fear, and that keeps your subconscious moving you towards it. Now, it's a really easy thing to slip into the trap of thinking about what you don't want. That's what happens when you worry. Worry is like negative goal setting. When you worry, you're picturing in your mind what you don't want to happen. And without you realizing what you're doing, you're actually sending that command to your subconscious. Not many people follow their worries all the way through into complete self-sabotage. Here's what most people do, and a lot of us in the room will be doing this in different ways. A lot of people do this. Think about what they want. It commands their subconscious to move towards it, but they don't achieve what they want as quickly as they think they should, so they go into self-doubt. Well, maybe I'm not going to achieve it. And by thinking about themselves not achieving, they're actually telling their subconscious to step back. Most people are limiting their own motivation, limiting their own confidence, limiting their own achievements, and limiting their own wealth because they're thinking about failure as well as success. The more we're able to hold our mind on what we want to achieve, the more powerfully we command our subconscious to move us towards it. So how do you maintain that difficult balance of being aware of the dangers and what's wrong, but staying for the majority of the time focused on what you desire and what's right? Well, set goals. All that happens when you set a goal is you join two or more brain cells together. And at first, when you first set the goal, the connection between the brain cells doesn't last. It comes apart again. And so you need to remind yourself of the goal every day for a minimum of 10 days, but 30 days or more is better, because each time you're reminding yourself of the goal, you strengthen the brain cell connection. First goal that I set, learn to read. I didn't go back to school. There wasn't any night class, instruction, tuition. I just told myself every day, I can read, I can read, I can read, I can read, I can read. And that was the hard part, because my brain was screaming, no, you can't, no, you can't, no, you can't. And that was the reality. I couldn't, and I'd not been able to throughout my life. Free will is an amazing thing. The latest area of brain research is called neuroplasticity. And the focus of the research is when you set a goal, it stimulates the brain cells to make new connections, release chemicals like serotonin, which give you winning attitudes that empower your behavior, that motivates you towards the achievement of the goal. It doesn't happen by accident. You see, I used to think success was an accident, like winning the lottery, it was chance. And winning the lottery, of course, is chance. But life success, the type of success people are talking about here on the stage, where they've worked for something, focused on it, that happens on purpose. There are principles of success that govern the process of creation. The more we are clear about what we want to achieve and why, the more we command our subconscious to move towards it. It took me a year to teach myself to read well. For the last 13 years, I've worked with one of the world's leading dyslexia associations. They've tested me lots of times. I still have dyslexia, but I've made some new brain cell connections that have compensated for it. I can't. It felt so good to learn to read at age 30. I just can't, you know. It felt like being given a key to set me free. Because here's the thing. I think most adults just take reading and writing for granted because they've been doing it a lot of years. But if you can't do it and then you can, it feels something special. And my upline, bless him, now died, but he helped me not only understand this, but he led me to the product table and introduced me to the books that changed lives. And I made the decision, I'm not going to read the newspaper today because it's mostly bad news. And I'm not going to read that magazine or that comic. I'm not even going to read that novel. I'm going to read more of the information about how you achieve success in life, how you turn your dreams into realities. And I needed it because I was still in £1 million of debt and my parents' home was going to be repossessed. And they were 65. And I just thought, I will read all the books. I will do whatever it takes because they are not going to be homeless at 65. Now, it didn't happen quickly. It took me 10 years to pay back the debt. But within the first 18 months, I've made enough progress that the banks and the different people the money was owed to were pleased with what I was doing, and they agreed that my parents could keep their home, and gradually I got the debt paid off. I learned to speed read, and I just read lots and lots and lots of personal development books, and they were all saying the same basic thing: success is not an accident. And the more I studied it, the more I used it, the more it helped me. And the thing that I really started to understand is, you can read the books, but they will make no difference in your life unless you actually do something with the information. There are really three things that make the difference. What to, why to, how to. The what to is information about what it is you want to achieve. The why to is why that is important for you, the emotional feeling. And then the how to, you need some techniques, some tools you can put into practice. And as I use the simple techniques of positive thinking and goal setting, so my life took off in all the areas. I felt more confident, I was more happy, I was paying off the debt. Other people wanted to know, how have you achieved that? And so I started making presentations for other people in my team and other friends and family and different groups. And then gradually I was spending more and more time running trainings, and then somebody recommended me to the Anthony Robbins organization that had set up in London, and I became an employed trainer for Tony Robbins. And then 18 months later, that was in 1993, and about 18 months later, I was headhunted by another American organization, Stephen Covey. And I was brought in to teach his program in big corporates, and his program was called The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. And so I was working as a trainer, but the thought that was always in my mind was, why are we not teaching this simple brain science and goal setting to our children as standard in state education? I lost count of how many people said to me, Brian, I wish I'd seen this when I was young. And I was thinking the same thing. Why didn't somebody show this to me years ago? It was like the missing piece of the puzzle in my head. Now, there are lots of good teachers in schools, and a lot of them will encourage you to set a goal and go for it. But being told what to do is not the same as being explained how. Goal setting is a science. There's a right way and a wrong way. And if you don't understand the right way and you don't set the goal in the right way, you probably won't achieve it. Not because you can't, just because it hasn't influenced your own subconscious. And so I made it my mission. I read all of the books about goal setting. I want to know what's the very best way of setting goals, and then I'm going to go teach it to children. I thought about it endlessly, day and night. I spoke to all the experts around the world. And then driving my car late one night through London, about 11 o'clock at night, thinking about it all and how important it is to activate both sides of the brain, the left brain that thinks in words and the right brain that thinks in pictures, I had this flash into my mind, and this is a goal map. And a goal map is always created using words and pictures so that you activate both sides of the brain. The words are for the left brain, so you can be clear and precise with the words. The pictures, like a dream board, really important, because through the pictures you command your subconscious. Your subconscious mind doesn't respond to words. See, if you're only writing a goal using words, it's not going to work. You have to use the combination of both. When you go to sleep at night, it's your conscious mind that goes to sleep. Your subconscious keeps working and produces dreams. Do you dream in words or pictures? It's pictures. It's the same around the world. It's the language of the subconscious. And if you want your subconscious to work with you, and this is what the top athletes are doing when they're visualizing themselves, clearing the bar, crossing the line, winning the race, you need to use imagery. The goal map is created by going through 7 steps. Step 1, use your right brain, look forwards, imagine what you want to achieve. Have a little dream for yourself. And there may be many things you want to achieve, and so the second step, use your left brain and work out what's the priority. Which one goal, once achieved, is going to help you to achieve other goals in your life. And of course, with forever, very often the main goal becomes reaching the next level in the plan, moving yourself along the business, because that's bringing you the benefits for the other areas of your life. Step 3, map it out. Map it out in both words and pictures, so you're activating both sides of your brain. And then step 4, and this is what's really important, get clear about the big why for you. The why is always going to be your most deepest, strongest, emotional motivating reasons. We're really not motivated by logic, we're motivated by emotion. Step 5, when. If you don't give a date, it's not a goal, it's a wish. And there's no power in that alone. When we give a date, now we can make it specific and we can start to work towards it. Step six, how? How are you going to do it? What are the actions you would need to take? And again, in forever, that's going to be things like introducing the business to people, hitting your CC volume, etc. Step seven, who? Who's going to be involved in the process? It's going to be your team, sometimes cross-line, upline, downline, etc. Maybe sometimes outside experts that are going to help. These seven steps are the critical aspects of conscious achievement. Goal mapping guides people through asking the questions and then captures their answers in words and pictures to activate both sides of the brain. Here's my map. One of my maps. I have many. My big goal is to reach 7 million people around the world. I'm a little bit more than halfway. It's just over 4 million somewhere. On either side of the main goal in the center are secondary goals. And these are areas where goal mapping is being used. Things like health and fitness and well-being, sport, in business, education, etc. How am I going to reach 7 million? Well, I've written 4 books that are in 15 languages. There's DVDs and CDs and online program. I make presentations every week somewhere in the world. Next week I'll be in Sweden, the week after that in Finland, the week after that in Italy. Often now with Forever running the full workshop on this as well as speaking at the different success days. The thing that's making the biggest difference is the other people teaching the system. And we have some people here with Sally. Sally Cassidy? Teaches the system well. And there are Diana Page is another person, teaches the system, Louise Barnacle. We have people in various countries now from Forever running workshops, teaching the system. And gradually that's getting out to more and more people. Sometimes when you come into an organization like Forever and you're being introduced to personal development, you're not always sure about it. I heard some people saying it earlier on today. They weren't sure about the mindset stuff at first. They start to realize how important it is. It's the thing that really helps people to move along in this business. Here's why. Imagine that whatever you do in life is like a bicycle you're riding. The bicycle represents your ability to do whatever you want to do. The back wheel of the bicycle represents your technical knowledge and skills. Now, you need to develop some knowledge in the Forever business, and you need to develop a little bit of ability, some skill, making presentations, those sorts of things. The front wheel of the bicycle, because we can steer, represents people skills, communication skills, being able to go out there, interact with other people. It's us, every day, to get up and ride the bicycle. Now, some days we get up and we pedal hard at our Forever business. And other days we're not feeling so great and we're looking for a more easy ride. What makes the difference between the days when we crank it and the days when we coast? Well, it comes down to who we're being. And in particular, 3 core qualities: drive or motivation, being able to hold a positive attitude, and summon up some confidence. Drive, attitude, and confidence determine what we do with the technical knowledge and the skills and how well we have a steer with other people. The days that we make the most progress in our life are not really determined by the terrain. It's not about how bumpy the road is, which way the wind's blowing. It's much more about who we are being. Who we are being when we're riding that bicycle. And whether we're doing our business with a good heart and a feeling of enthusiasm, just like the presentations have been saying today, because it's when we're in that state of mind that it helps us make the most progress. Now, you'll know from your own experience in life, it's really difficult to stay balanced on the bicycle if you're not moving towards something. And this is how it is in life. Each of us are like a bicycle. If we're not moving towards something, we lose our balance and we fall over. Having a sense of direction, having a goal, having a purpose gives us a momentum that helps us to pull through those difficult, bumpy patches and we come out the other side the stronger. And the real prize in setting goals is not really the thing that we achieve. It's who we become in the journey. And I've heard it from people again and again today. that while they've enjoyed building their forever business and while the income has done all sorts of things for them, it's who they've become, the growth that they've gone through as a person, how it's helped them to evolve themselves. That's the real prize, because that shines out in all the areas of our life and it can never be taken or lost. In the whole day workshop, and I have a workshop coming in Stirling on the 4th of March, we go through 7 principles of success. Each of these principles is universal. Once you understand it, you can use the principle in any area of your life to help you to achieve the things that are important to you. And obviously, we teach people the goal mapping system. Now, we don't have time to go through the principles today, but I want to show you how you build your goal map, because the best thing you can do for yourself after the presentation, if you don't already have one, is to download the free templates or use the online system and create your own map. Because it's not listening to me talk about it that makes it work. The system works really well if you work it. Working the system means creating your own map of what you want, so it programs your subconscious. Now, I have a special page that you can't find on my website. The only way you can find this page is if I give you the link. And the link is goalmapping.com/forever. The reason why I hide the page is because we give people access to the online system for free and all the material. And if you want to come to any of the workshops or you want the DVD or any of those things, the prices on this page are very different to the public prices on my website. So don't go to my ordinary website because it's going to cost you more. Go to the special Forever page and you'll find all of the information there, all of the links, and the online program, which looks like this, so you can go and build your map. Some people don't like to draw. If you like to draw, download the paper templates and draw your map. But if you don't like to draw, use the online system, which has an image library, and you can build your map easily in a really short space of time. So the first step is dream. And if you want to, you can click on the online program. There's a video of me guiding you through a visualization. It's about 10 minutes long, so you get a good picture of what it is you want to achieve. Then you enter your goals just in a list, and then in the second step, you can either use the online program or the templates, and you start to structure your goals. You choose one goal from your list that goes in the center as the main goal, and then you put other goals at the side, and these are your secondary goals. Then you draw the pictures, or if you're using the online program, you can upload photos or you can download stuff from the internet, and you start to build your map. Then you enter in your reasons why at the top. Things like freedom, family, financial security. Always the combination of words and pictures, so you activate both sides of your brain. Then you go to when, and you have a start date, a finish date, how, you put in the actions you're going to take, and then who. Might take you an hour to create your map, but it won't cost you any money. You can do it for free. If you have a mobile phone, you can sign up now and it will send you an email with the templates and the information. It's there at the top of the Forever page. Just go to goalmapping.com/forever and you'll see the details there just to enter in so you can follow through with the process. The key is, once you have your map, look at it once a day. Each time you look at your pictures, say the words so that you activate both sides of your brain, and then share it with like-minded people. Share it with your team. Share it upline, share it downline, because the map helps you to communicate your goals in a really simple way. I've been teaching this 20 years now, but my maps are right here because it works if I work it. You know, I know the system well, but knowing it doesn't make it work. Working it makes it work. This is my map about health and fitness. Here's my C9. I'm taking my aloe and argan B pollen. Right? So I have different maps about different things. I have a map about my business. I have a map about my health and fitness. Together with my children, I have a map. So here's my health and fitness map, my C9, and I'm doing a new one soon. This is a map from my daughter. Aisha. She did this when she was 7. This is all about her making the world a better place. And in contrast, here's a map from the senior team of Microsoft UK. So it's simple enough that a young child can do it. It's deep enough that the senior team from Microsoft are going to use it. In fact, Microsoft sent the system out around the world to 65,000 of their sales managers. They're so pleased with the results. And here's Diana Page, who's been goal mapping for the last 16 years, and every stage in her business, she's created a goal map for. And I was speaking to her recently, and she said she won't work with a new person now until they create a goal map of what they want to achieve in forever. Because that tells her that they're serious, and every time they get together, she says, bring your map, because she knows that by looking at the map, that's triggering the release of the chemicals like serotonin that's giving them the positive feeling that's helping them move towards the goal. This is the map I did for the release of my goal mapping book. It's in lots of languages. It's been reprinted many times. Lots of forever people I know have used it. If you extend out the detail of your map, it becomes a to-do list. And so my goal map and my to-do list sit side by side in my folder. The new thing that I've created, and you're the first people that I've told about it in a presentation, is the new online system. And again, if you just sign up on that Forever page, it will take you to it, absolutely free to use. The focus of the system is about making 2017 your best year yet. I heard, I think it was Natalie that was up here just now saying about how she pulls angel cards. I pull an angel card, and I'm also into numerology. I don't know if anyone's into numerology. This is a 1 year. It's all about new beginnings, new starts. Last year was a 9 year. That's a bit of a challenging number, 9, right? This year, a 1 year. This is a great time to set goals. If ever you're going to set a goal, if ever you're going to demonstrate belief in yourself, now is an absolutely great time to do it. Not only a 1 year, but we're in January, start of the year. Invest an hour in yourself. Go create your map. I would love to see some of you at the workshop in Stirling, but if you can't make the workshop, the video of the whole day of the workshop is on the online system. And if you go into it, each piece of video comes up, and it's me guiding you through. In fact, the first hour is just there free. Just go and use it. If you want to, you can then go and check your life balance, or you can go through the purpose finder and search your life purpose. And of course, you can create your maps online using the image library, or download your own images from the internet or upload them. You get your own folder and you can create your map, words and pictures, activate both sides of your brain. As you go around the system, it helps you. There's workbook pages you can download. And then the thing that I'm really looking forward to is I'm about to start the Life Path webinar journey. And so starting in February, once a month, I'll be doing an hour-long webinar focused on the different life areas, guiding people into creating a goal map for that area of their life. So the first webinar will be focused on authentic happiness and creating a goal map for happiness. You look at that map for 1 month to form the brain cell connections so that they become beliefs and commands to your subconscious. Then a month later, I take people through the next webinar, which is all about developing great levels of self-esteem, feeling fantastic. Again, you look at it for 1 month. The third webinar is all about well-being and vibrancy. Again, you look at the map for 1 month to form the brain cell connections. Fourth webinar is about financial freedom and building your forever business. Fifth webinar, it's all about harmonious relationships. And the sixth webinar is about living with purpose. There is already an overview webinar that's in the system that, again, you can go and access for free. Through the months, you create the maps. It programs your subconscious, and it helps you to follow through and have your best year. So, we're at the end of the presentation. It works so well if you work the system. And again, it's not listen to me talk about it that makes it work. You could be in the whole day workshop, but if you don't do your map, it won't really make a difference. You may come out with a good feeling, but the map helps you to follow through. The key to it is simply learning to think your best thoughts. If you think your best thoughts, it triggers the chemical release of serotonin that helps you to feel your best feelings. That influences you into taking your best actions, and you invariably live your best life. The map is just there to help you stay on track. It's been really nice to be here. I hope the presentation has served you. Please create your map. It's that makes the difference. Bless you all, everyone. Thank you.